This is the story of the Triassic Moenkopi Formation, a post-apocalyptic rock layer that preserves the survivors of the Great Dying. My name is Benjamin Berger, and I'm a geologist in Utah. And in this episode of The Rocks of Utah, we're investigating one of the most iconic red rock layers of Utah's geological record, the Triassic Moenkopi Formation. The Triassic period was named in 1834 by Frederick von Alberti after three distinct red, white, and gray layers of rock that are found across Europe. The name Triassic refers to these three layers deposited between 252 to 101 million years ago, a period of time of over 50 million years. Here in Utah, the Triassic period is well represented by a series of rock layers that don't exactly match the three specific rock layers of Europe. The Moenkopi is one of the oldest and lowest of these layers, representing nearshore marine deposits, or kind of more specifically tidal flats along the western coastline of the supercontinent, Pangaea. To the northwest in Idaho and Wyoming, the Moenkopi Formation kind of interfingers with the fully marine limestone of the Thames Formation, which is notable for containing a diverse fauna of Triassic ammonites. Some geologists define the Moenkopi Formation as a group of rock layers that contain multiple formations or members, including names like Black Dragon, Sinbad, Torrey, Moody Canyon, and the Ankara. Although there are many other names for various exposures of the Moenkopi Formation in New Mexico and Arizona to the south. The outcrops of the Moenkopi Formation are found throughout the four states of Utah, Colorado, Arizona, and New Mexico, and is one of the classic red rock layers that's preserved throughout the four corners of these states. Now, the lowest beds of the Moenkopi Formation represent rock layers that were deposited during the Smithian Age, while the upper beds of the Moenkopi were deposited during the Spathian Age of the Early Triassic. Now, recent publications suggest that the Smithian Age lasted only 2 million years, from 251 to 249 million years ago, while the Spathian Age was from 249 to 247 million years ago. The two ages are represented by an extinction event. It's not as severe or as global as the 252 million year old extinction at the Permian-Triassic boundary, which would be below these layers of rock out here. Is that boundary that ushered in the Mesozoic era. So all these rocks are Mesozoic that we're looking at, and all of them are Triassic. Rocks from the Spathian Age are more fossiliferous, indicating a rich marine fauna around 248 million years ago. That's just 4 million years after the Great End Permian extinction. The time of the deposition of the Moenkopi Formation represents a post-apocalyptic time span, still in the recovery of the End Permian extinction. So these tidal flats, these deposits, rarely contain any fossils. So the unit is principally dated from zircons or paleomagnetic studies, as well as the correlation of the marine deposits of the Thames Formation, which does preserve ammonites, with the Moenkopi Formation. So dinosaurs had yet to evolve during this time. They would soon make their first appearance in the overlaying rock layers. In fact, the top sandstone up here is the Guardia sandstone, which is in the Chinle Formation, and that's where we find the first dinosaurs. So the ancestors of dinosaurs might be lurking in some of these older Triassic rocks. So that's kind of why I'm out here spending some time investigating these red beds for any clues to see if we can find any clue that there might be some fossils in it. So right here we have some really kind of neat deposits. These are some salts that are in the Moenkopi. So these are some bedded gypsum. And so what's really neat about this outcropping here is that we can see that there is a lot of salt in between here. So the salt was coming from the evaporation of this ancient seaway that we're on the margin of, here on the coastline of Pangaea. We're near the equator at the time, so it's very warm. The other thing we're seeing is some of these undulating beds, some sedimentary structures here. They're indicating probably like ripple marks and things like that you would find in a tidal mudstone, you know, in tidal systems even today. So existing in the early Triassic. So we're pretty close to the ocean, and some of these inlets into the sea would get trapped and start to evaporate and then deposit these salts. So fair thick layers of these evaporitic deposits in the Moenkopi. So here's some of those ripple marks. So these are ancient ripple marks along the seashore during the early Triassic. And they look just like ripples today that you'd find along the ocean. So the Moenkopi Formation gets its name from a geographic location, from the little town of Moenkopi in Arizona, which is in the Hopi Nation. And Moenkopi means running water in the Hopi language. Now the correlation across the Moenkopi Formation from Utah, New Mexico, Arizona seem to indicate that the Moenkopi Formation is oldest in the northeastern parts of Utah and younger further south in southern Utah, as well as New Mexico and in Arizona, where it tends to be a little bit younger. Now this would kind of indicate that there was a transgression of an ocean kind of southeastward, where it fingers in with these carbonate limestones that can be found between rock layers of the Moenkopi Formation. So it's those interfingering carbonate limestones that we often find preserved fossils in. And most of those are actually marine fossils. So here's one of these carbonate blocks. Oh man, a lot of red ants underneath there. Sorry, ants. These are good places to look for fossils. So I just found this. This is some petrified wood. This may have come down from the overlying Chinle Formation, which has a lot of petrified wood in it. So it's difficult to say if this is Moenkopi or Chinle. Looks a little beat up. Might be tumbled down from stratigraphically higher up. So the Moenkopi Formation is thinner in southern Utah, and it rests on top of the Permian Oregon Rock Formation of the Cutler Group, an early Permian Kanab limestone. Now it's reported that the contact with the Moenkopi Formation on top of the old Kanab limestone, which is actually early Permian down in Arizona, was initially exposed to rain and weathering. So it has a very weathered contact before the onset of the deposition of the Moenkopi Formation on top of it. Whereas up here in Utah to the north, the Moenkopi lies directly on actually an earlier Triassic unit called the Dinwoodie Formation, which is the very bottom of this ridge out here that's in these gray beds at the very bottom, which represent the oldest part of the Triassic series here in Utah. So we have a little bit of a thicker section here in Utah than you do down in the Four Corners area, where the Moenkopi sits right on top of the Permian deposits. But yeah, some pretty big beds of gypsum in this. Fortunately, that makes it difficult for fossilization to occur. Breaks up any of fossils, but could be some. Just need to spend some time looking. So workers tend to study and spend more time in the layers above the Moenkopi Formation, in the fossil-rich late Triassic Chinle Formation, which represents more terrestrial and fluvial deposits, including petrified forests and some early dinosaurs like the coelophysoids, as well as rich deposits of uranium. Now, one of the types of vertebrate fossils that have been found in the Moenkopi Formation is a group of amphibians called temnospondyls. They include four genera, creatures like Welosaurus, Cyclotosaurus, Quasicyclosaurus, and all of these are actually found down in Arizona and New Mexico. However, there's one temnospondyl that's been found here in Utah, and that's Paratorosuchus from the Tory member of the Moenkopi Formation of Utah. So it's the only one that we know of from Utah. Now, there are only two reptile fossils that are actually known from the Moenkopi Formation, and they're both found in Arizona. The first is the Papilosaur arizonosaurus and the Trilophosauridae, which is a genus called Ansodontosaurus. Both of these are archosaurs, or primitive archosaurs, and they're distantly related to dinosaurs. So none of these creatures have been found from Utah. However, trackways, reptile trackways, have been reported from near where I am exploring today. So hopefully we can find some body fossils. Not hopeful, no one else has reported any from this area, but we'll check it out, see what we can find. Like a good layer over here. I think one of the things that makes the Moenkopi exciting to me, at least, is that, you know, any fossil discovery, no matter how small, could be significant since so little is actually known from the formation. So even though we're probably not likely to find any fossils out here, it's worth looking for. So checking out these outcrops. So the Triassic Moenkopi Formation is kind of an interesting unit because it's a shell, meaning shale, meaning that it's fairly flat, breaks in these flat pieces, mostly mudstone. So it's turning out to be kind of a nice day. It was cold and raining when I first got here, and now the sun's come out. Hopefully it'll stay out and we'll have clear skies. So it's kind of fun to come out to these places that are in the middle of nowhere. So I know a place that's near here where we can find some amazing rock art. So thanks for watching this video. It's great to be back in the field this spring out in the sunshine finally, and a lot of it's due to my Patreon supporters. So including the kind folks of Max McGregor, Sean Gormit, Brian Clever, Pablo Lozato Figuez, Arcotis 1811, Justin Bovey, Emmett Larson, Marlo, and Draco, and Fred Olney. I don't make a lot of money doing these videos, but I was able to actually purchase a new drone recently and some better microphones, and I'm hoping to make these videos hopefully a little more professional than this one, but stay tuned. I'll be making some new videos this summer and as part of the Rocks of Utah series, so stay tuned, and thanks for watching.